welcoming us to their space tonight. They've got a great facility, some cutting edge stuff going on here, so we're going to get a nice preview of kind of the technology that they use here and all of that great stuff. We've got a couple of giveaways coming up tonight too, with some head-mounted displays that are on the way right now. We've got Steve. Another tough one, thank you. He's going to give us a little preview of his book. He wrote a great book called Practical Augmented Reality, which I think is one of the top books on augmented reality that's available now. So he's going to tell us a little bit about that. We've got all sorts of counseling rooms from all sorts of different areas. This is actually our 1-year anniversary. I just realized yesterday that we started 1 year ago today. It was our first meeting. And we had about 12 people sign up. I think about 8 showed up, and it was half virtual reality and it was half drones. So it was very weird and it didn't fit together at all. So those were our humble beginnings. We go from that 1 year ago today to now we're well over 300 members and growing. And people now actually know what virtual reality is a lot more out in the world. So we didn't know if there were enough people that kind of understood what it was and the technology to start the group out. And now it's kind of time to evolve. It's great to see how much it's kind of grown and evolved. So just a little bit about myself, and then we'll kind of start out. We'll go around the room. Last meeting, this is one of my favorite parts of the meeting, just because there was so much talent from so many different areas that everybody, it's just nice to have everybody kind of coming together in one room and contribute in so many different ways. So just a little bit about myself. Blair Adams is my name. I've got my own company called Digital Destinies, where I do some virtual reality and augmented reality work, some 3D motion graphic kind of things. And I'm also working with a company now, a day job, which is a very weird thing for me, doing app development for Chameleon Tower. They do different sorts of visualization applications. So they're getting into some virtual reality and augmented reality sort of things. The application I'm working on right now is for garage doors, and basically it lets you go through and design a garage door with more options you'd ever imagine would be possible for a garage door. And you can take a picture of your house and sort of carve out the space and place the garage door right on your house so you can see what it looks like in actual environment. A few more bells and whistles inside there, but that is the basics of that. That's me. So I guess we'll go ahead and turn around the room and figure out who else is here. Start.
My name is Andre Rocky. I do C, C++, OpenGL programming. I don't go to college. I'm just about to finish high school.
Oh, great. How did you find out about the meet up here?
Okay. I'm Kat Mitchell, 16-year-old Android developer, and that's about it.
That's great, though. I mean, how do you even, so you guys are both in?
Yeah.
Okay, alright, what school?
Cold school.
Okay, alright, great. And you guys were at the Wayne State stuff before,
yeah.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay,
alright,
great.
Hi, it's Michael, and my hobby is on the microcontroller Arduino computer vision, so kind of things. I also work on the C++ programming project.
Hi, my name is Johan. I work for Walbridge, a general contractor located in downtown Detroit. And I work under the technology department, most work related to BIM, building machine modeling for constructions.
Hi, my name is Matt Curtin. I'm a lead programmer and learning technology consultant for Innovative Learning Group, and we develop learning solutions for large organizations. Over the years, web-based training and mobile learning, and looking also to get into training solutions based on virtual reality.
Hi, I'm Chris Comer. I've been a VR enthusiast for probably about 20 years. Developed head trackers about 10 years ago, selling them. And now I'm more into the VR streaming, doing some research on that. So.
Hi, I'm Paul Emery. I'm one of the coordinators who doesn't know where to park. Anyway, I got here. And today we have 3 of these to give away. So I thought what I'd do is pass around 3x5 cards, and you can just put your name on it, and then we'll put them all in a, you know, a bag, and I'll, if you give me $5, I'll be able to.
Pull your name up first, definitely.
Yeah. I'm mostly interested in multi-user applications that come from Second Life and OpenSim, and I'm fooling around with taking stuff I build collaboratively, because OpenSim is a collaborative environment. More than one avatar can work on a project at the same time. Anyway, and then moving that into Unity, but also there are now viewers for Second Life and OpenSim that work with the Riff, and I would have brought it today, but next time.
A couple things. VR Tix was nice enough to get in contact with us and give us a few of their headsets to give away. So it's nice we're kind of getting on the map now, and hopefully we'll have some Oculus Rifts and some Vives to give away to media soon. Right now we're doing pretty good with these. And let's see.
One other thing, and just lost it. So.
How about just passing these around, and whoever's on the end, collect them, and then we'll just do a drawing.
Yep, that sounds good to me.
Just think that. Just take one and write your name on it, and then
okay.
Let's see. You do have to have a phone, so probably, I don't know, maybe. I will figure that out. If you win and you don't happen to have a device that it works on, we'll figure something out. But the idea is for you to give a report at the next month on how what your experience was with it.
Yeah, definitely. Yep, so Paul was talking a little bit about the Second Life and OpenSim, so that's kind of his specialty. And he gave us a pretty nice preview of how, at the last meeting, of how you can get inside of Second Life, and without having to know any 3D modeling or animation, you can start to make virtual reality applications.
Yeah, it has build tools that are like not much more difficult to learn than SketchUp.
Okay. Thanks. And, we got here, one. Yeah, we've what we're doing, just introducing ourselves, how we're into virtual reality around the area.
My name's Ralph. I just want to make apps. I'm a UX designer during the day, so that's about it.
Ralph has volunteered to help us out. Just to give you a little idea about kind of how our meetings are set up, because we've got a lot of new people here tonight. We kind of have two different tracks that are open to everybody. The first one is kind of what this meeting is here, so it's an open general meeting. Normally these are a little bit more structured, and they'll kind of go through a Prezi presentation and kind of talk about one subject or another subject, and a lot of discussion around that. This tonight's going to be a little bit more open, so we get a chance to kind of preview the great space and see what's going on here and do some networking. Then the other half of our groups is more of kind of a hands-on group. So the first one, you don't need any experience for anything. We kind of teach you from the beginning right now. But the other group is more, you bring your laptop in, we're going to take you from beginning to end and let you create your own virtual reality project right inside of Unity or inside of another development environment. We've done that a couple of times already. Ralph's going to kind of take over for us for next time, and we'll talk about a little bit later on tonight too, some of the different projects and ideas. This next one's going to be a little more of the introductory kind of level, and then I'm thinking probably in the next one after that, we'll hopefully kind of step things up and maybe get into some Vive applications. There's like a one idea that I had is that there's a make your own tilt brush sort of application that's out there that we could do, that we could probably get through in a 2 or 3 hour. We'll probably maybe do that one on a Saturday or something, so we can kind of spread the time out a little bit more for that one. So just to give you a
yeah, if people have skills and are willing to demonstrate, see the man here and he'll put you on the schedule.
Yeah, definitely. I'd rather be sitting in the back row right now than standing up here. So if anybody wants to volunteer to kind of take a little bit of time away from me, I would appreciate it. There's so much talent inside of here, too. So I really want to encourage, you know, everybody to kind of share what you're doing, share what you're working on.
Show off.
Show off, yeah. This is a great place to kind of show off. You got a great audience for it. So go ahead.
I'm here. My name is Sultan Sharif. I'm a filmmaker. I just came back from L.A. I got into the VR world mainly through Sundance. I was in the Sundance Maker Day Lab and then the Oculus Launchpad program. But I'm more in like the 360 video side, so either documentary but also like narrative approach. And then I'm doing a project right now with the Detroit Narrative Agency, which is a part of Allied Media Projects. And we got funded for a really small virtual 360 video shoot that we're planning.
Okay, nice. Very cool. Yeah, and I'm a little more of the kind of expert on the sort of Unity, that sort of development environment side, the camera side. I know a little bit in that area, but I definitely need some help. So if anybody wants to kind of help out in that area and kind of come up here and tell us a little bit about kind of the latest, greatest cameras or what's kind of being done on that side, it's a whole presentation for everybody.
My name is Charles Powell. I'm an electrical engineer by day. I work at GM. I started a startup, Reality Inc. Basically doing VR content and augmented reality content, 360 videos, some game development, and other things like that.
Okay, cool. What was the name of your company, you said?
Dot Reality Incorporated.
All right, great.
Thanks. My name is Mo. I don't know how to program or write code, but I'm a writer, and after I purchased my first VR system, I kind of got the feeling that the future of VR was going to be really sort of intermixed with story and like film and that kind of thing. So, and I've always been a VR enthusiast, and to see it become real after I bought a Vive, I was just so blown away that I just wanted to meet like-minded people.
So. Did you bring it?
No. It has light boxes.
So this
and that's
VR meetup is probably the one place in town that doesn't have a Vive, a Rift, or anything else. Interesting.
All
this
year.
Yeah.
Well, we've had them on before, so you know they're all. We've already seen that.
Yeah. Well, we go back and forth. We don't always solve our time kind of dealing with same bias. But was that your first experience with curiosity when you?
When I bought the Vive, actually.
You ever tried VR before or anything?
When I was probably about maybe 12, I tried a really cheesy version, and I could see the potential, so I kind of dreamt of it and never thought it would happen until I read about the Vive and I read about the different systems available. So I went up to, I forget what mall it was, up in Novi or Birmingham, and I tried it at the Microsoft store.
Okay.
And so I bought it the next day and, you know, just thought it was amazing. And
that's pretty much all it takes with that one time putting it out.
Yeah. And if anybody's ever played, like, I don't know if there's any gamers in here, but I grew up kind of a gamer. And if you ever played The Last of Us on PS4, which is a game that you just can't forget. And it was really all about story more than anything. And so I just see this as being the future of gaming and a lot of things. So.
Hey, I'm Chris. I'm a videographer, and I also have a Vive. I've been wanting to get more into VR, maybe try making a game sometime. So that's why I'm here.
And you can do video selfies.
Yeah, it's difficult actually.
And Chris helps us out a lot too on doing the video for us. He's brought us by a few times for us to kind of play around and try. So, appreciate
it. Hi, my name is Peter Gunther. I teach the Java Boot Camp at Grand Circus downtown, and I also do some Unity work. I'll be teaching a Unity workshop at Grand Circus end of November, beginning of December.
Shudny Shimanov, I'm a front-end developer at GTB. I took the front-end bootcamp at Grand Circus, and now I'm employed. Actually, thankfully, did a Detroit VR meetup because I met a recruiter from there and got my job through here, so a lot of love for this meetup. But kind of like Mo was talking about, I think a lot of the public thinks that VR and AR is kind of a gimmick, and I think it's going to be the next big platform. So I'm just excited about what you guys are doing here.
So standard is 15% for your first 2 years.
No,
time that that happened, you know, when we started organizations for the job seekers and the employers kind of coming into the same area and making those connections. So, good to hear.
Hey, my name is John Beckis. I'm a web developer at Jackson Dawson, and you know, big VR fan for a long time. I started playing around with 3JS, you know, a year or so ago, and then once Mozilla built on that and started making their A-frame framework, I moved into that a little bit more. So my interest is really in developing VR content for the web.
So you were looking into the whole web VR thing, is that right?
Yep.
Remember that from last time around?
Okay, correct.
Great. So hopefully it's going to be up here pretty soon, given this a nice little feature with web VR, and all that stuff. I think that might be the pizza that's coming right now. So
that's
keep growing up.
Has everybody got a pencil that's okay. Interested in getting a card in the
back? Do you want the name on there?
Just some identifying, yeah. You know, your social security number.
Do we slip the money in the card or do we talk to you about it?
They have to do that without anybody else knowing about it.
Did I miss anything?
My name is Corey Sunday. I am the founder of the West Michigan ARVR Meetup. I have a music label called Crumbin Records where I've done I have an unfinished web VR website that I've been lazy on, and then also I run a news company in Kalamazoo. I've just migrated to the Detroit area called Burning Crow Media, in which we're starting in virtual tours, going to maybe move into augmented, and then we're going to focus on enterprise applications and educational applications. So.
Oh, great. So are you still?
I'm still the organizer there, but okay. I haven't been active in a couple of months. So.
Okay, thanks.
Josh Berger, my background's in finance, so I don't have a cool intro or anything like that. Corey actually turned me on to VR. He'd been talking about it for a couple of years, and I finally got to experience it with Gear about 3 months ago. I was really blown away by it, so just here to see what's new and evolving in VR.
Rob Mihal, I worked with EDS and HP for many years. We had the Detroit VR Center, which was in the New Center area, Upper Con building from 95 to 99, and then moved out to Troy from 2000 to 2008 or so. And we moved on to doing different things, but I was trying to stay in touch with it by keeping involved in meetings like this. Mostly we did more commercial type applications, industrial, automotive, retail, military, defense, that sort of thing. Not much in the gaming side.
Okay, great. Yep, so Robbie Makery, what do we call that, a document that has all sorts of research on VR and kind of what's going on in some of the areas. So he's 20 years, obviously, a great expert in the area, so I appreciate his input. Cliff.
Hi, my name is Cliff Samuel Jr. Day job is with the Michigan Department of Health and Human Services, the STD Surveillance Division of Detroit. Just here to keep with technology, you know, trust your techno must.
Hi, I'm John Brabs, and I work with Rob when we had the VR facility at EDS and HP, and I've been involved with between 3D visualization and virtual reality for almost, I guess, close to 30 years now, so working with the Powerwalls caves, head-mounted displays, simulator, like crew station simulators and stuff, so just trying to keep involved with all this.
Hi, I'm Karen Burton. My background is in architecture and construction. I have a meetup group called Space Lab Detroit. We talk about innovation in the built environment professions, both the technology side and the business side. And we're going to open a co-working space by the same name very soon. for the same audience, for the built environment audience. Blair is going to be presenting at an event next week for the Society for Marketing Professional Services. He's going to be the moderator for our BRAR panel discussion.
Yep, so if anybody can make it out for that, I'll post some information on our page too, so you can kind of know a little bit more about what that's all about.
Tisa Kapuru, I'm a student here at Airport. My instructors, Alan, Ms. Christ. And so I've been working, I work for different independent companies and things doing augmented reality. I've been working for 13 years making Second Life content, and then their new VR platform, Sonar, so which is coming soon.
So Sonar is like a Second Life extension, or
it's an entire it's wiping out the Second Life. They're going to cut that out and then switch to Sonar, which is a total VR platform.
Okay. Hi, my name is Leah Jafar, and I'm a student here. I like gum. I like potatoes. And it's really good.
I'm making really does like potatoes.
Yeah, a lot.
It's great. It's awesome. And I'm just making a mini RPG game for myself. And I'm in school. That's all I got.
Maybe leave the RPG game and then follow up with yourself.
I'm Greg Good. I've been doing various IP or development for like the last 20 years or so. I have a long interest in 3D, been tinkering with that. Done some electronic stuff. I'm a professional photographer. My main thing though is I'm a programmer, both the web and desktop. And I've been tinkering with Unity a little bit, but I just need to stay focused and take all the different things I can do and put them into one project and keep moving with it. So this is a good place to keep that, you know, that fire under your belly, you know, to keep doing it. So.
My name is Steve Box-Dekalmas. I've been working with stereoscopic, fully immersive and augmenting displays since 1990. I joined the faculty at the University of Washington. Also directed a lab for Mississippi State University, using the same tools from the early days of the BPL iPhone and fixed-based balloons. A former program manager for the National Science Foundation in this area as well. He has a copy of my third book on the topic, which was just published by Pearson, the academic publisher. 23 chapters plus, 453 pages, 23 chapters and two appendices, 405 bibliographic citations, 263 images, and 21 tables. It goes through the mechanics of the eye and ties all of that into the design of head-mounted displays. It goes into the mechanics of your sense of hearing and ties that into binaural three-dimensional sound. It discusses in detail the mechanics of your sense of touch and how the mechanoreceptors in the fingers allow you to distinguish between, for instance, the texture of the floor and the texture of a cantaloupe, and ties all of that into different tactile and force feedback devices, and that if you're involved in the design of the hardware or the design of the software or different gaming apps and so on. For instance, understanding the 21 different extra-retinal and on-retina cues that the eye uses in order to help perceive depth in images, it can help you immensely in the design of your content. The book goes into human factors considerations. Why are more than half the people that use fully immersive displays getting sick? Talks about convergence, accommodation decoupling in the eye, and how the goes into the future of these technologies. Talking about the stuff that's coming out of the various companies where we're moving away from using flat panel arrays and thick optics down to pupil-forming optical systems that allow you to reduce the size of the displays. companies, for instance, Ioptic, that are moving the optical system off of the display and integrating it into a wearer, a daily wear contact lens, so that the displays can actually get down to the size of a pair of woolly sunglasses. The final third of the book goes into detailed application studies. I think only 6 pages in the entire book have to do with entertainment. And the rest of it is applications in aerospace, defense, general aviation, augmenting displays that will take ADS-B data that's being broadcast from the aircraft now and from ground stations and overlay that spatially correlated into the pilot's real-world view. So it remains stable as you're looking around, so you can see air routes and different aircraft and air positions, restricted airspace. If you want to stay out of restricted airspace, don't fly into the red area type of thing. Medical applications, architectural applications, and so on. So that's the nature of the book. It was written for the university market to provide a grounding on, yeah, it's cool technology, but understanding the intricacies of the human perceptual system, as well as how these technologies operate, gives people an excellent foundation, if you're, especially if you're working with it on a daily basis. So that's
great. Going to be a test at the end of the night, so I hope everybody will pay attention to that. But it's great, though, that you know there's opportunities, I think, all across the VR space, from people that don't have any technical knowledge at all to people that are have been doing this kind of stuff for 20 years and understand it on a whole bunch of different levels. So, yeah, it's nice that we can all kind of, was that kind of?
It might seem like a funny question, but you said accommodation decoupling. Can you just tell me what that is?
Okay, so, when you're looking at an object that's coming towards you, there's two functions that are taking place in the eye. One is accommodation, so your eye is changing focus, so the crystalline lens is actually changing shape. Make sure I get this explanation right.
So it's the decoupling part, I think, that you got me with.
Okay, so the decoupling takes place because you have a flat panel array in front of each eye, so you have a two-dimensional surface upon which you're displaying the combination of the two simulates actual depth of field. And but in order to remain focused on that, so if a virtual object is moving towards you, the normal coordinated activity of the eye, both accommodating as well as the eyes bending inward, detaches. And so a lot of people experience, for instance, headaches when they're using this, and it's caused by that decoupling of the two ocular functions taking place. The eyes are not bending in the way that they should. The vergence is detached from the normal rate at which, or the normal accommodation function. And so as you're moving like this, the movement of the eyes inward or outwards, as well as the focus, that's very tightly coupled processes. But when you're looking at flat panel arrays that are close in front of the eyes, those two processes are decoupled. And they don't happen at the same rate because you have to stay focused on these 2D surfaces.
So they're gonna be active in it, so I have a few kids, and if they go to use my VR, I won't let them. And they say, why? I say, because I don't know how it's going to affect your eyes yet. And I know that while they're still growing, the accommodation is working. And if they hurt that, then that's, for a kid, that's a lot of work to fix that again.
There's a lot of long-term, it's only been the last couple of years that fully immersive stereoscopic displays where the price point has come down to the point where they can be mass manufactured and people can actually use these in large numbers. And so there's been no formal scientific studies that have been done on the long-term impact of extended use of these systems. And inside of the book, we go into tremendous detail about this with lots of bibliographic citations to the existing body of knowledge on this. But it's there's a group of people watching this industry very closely because of these particular things that you raise, and it's law firms. Because as these systems get out there more and so on, if they start to find that there are long-term perceptual side effects, that opens up the industry to massive class action lawsuits. As a case in point, the use of Google Glass while driving, that's already been tested in the courts already. Another one is, so the issues regarding visually induced motion sickness, when you have the visual sensation of motion, but without the corresponding vestibular cues, simulator sickness. This is actually, the symptoms are the exact inverse of motion sickness. For instance, when you're inside of a boat in stormy seas and you have the vestibular sensation of motion, but you don't have the corresponding visual cues. They're just inverses of each other. They result in the exact same. So they call it, in the science community, stomach awareness, and then cold sweats, and then nausea, and so on. And the existing scientific literature points out that while you can adapt, so people that initially start getting sick using the Vive or the Oculus systems and so on, after repeated use, you'll adapt to that. But there's perceptual consequences after you stop, which is why they always, inside of the user books, advise not operating, for instance, an automobile for several hours afterwards, because you have there's lasting perceptual consequences from the use of these things. This is, the human factors aspect of this field is just fascinates me, because of the, not so much the consequences of it, but the design of these systems, they require thick optics because we have to use flat panel arrays because there's so few other display technologies that you can use inside of a head-mounted system right now. The work that's being done by Magic Leap, where they will use, instead of an imaging surface in front of the eyes, they will use the retina of the eye as the imaging surface. So they'll be projecting directly in onto the retina of the eye. Groups out of the University of Washington have been developing displays that use laser diodes and fast-moving mirrors and so on to scan the images rapidly onto the eye. As soon as these new display technologies that are specifically intended for this field get developed, I almost guarantee within the next 2 to 3 years, your Vives, your Oculus systems, Gear VR, these things, and so on, maybe not the low-cost ones, but the commercially available flat panel display-based head-mounted displays are going to be gathering dust, and they're going to be displaced by dual-use augmenting displays. Optical see-through displays, displays that you can overlay information, as for instance a head-up display, overlay information that's spatially correlated with your surroundings, and just by adding a clip-on darker shade or increasing the luminosity in the display, that you'll be able to, they'll serve a dual purpose. And the Vive systems and the Oculus systems and all of that that are based on flat panel arrays are going to be gathering dust, and they'll give way. These things, a lot of these, I've tried a lot of these things already. They're already tinkering with them in the labs, gearing up assembly lines for them and all that. And so in the next few years, definitely going to see major moves away from these large, bulky things that hang off the front of your face to a lot more streamlined stuff.
I was going to ask you whether or not the augmented glasses would offset the problem of accommodation because you're looking through them.
Absolutely.
As opposed to looking at something in front of your eyes.
Absolutely, because you'll be...
I was talking to Blair about this. Like, that might be a good topic itself, just to talk about unit vectors and how it can affect people.
I'm being woefully left out.
Can I get my intro?
Oh, I'm sure.
Definitely.
Okay, so
Allen Consumer.
My background has nothing to do with any of this, oddly enough. So the state of education, I end up teaching this stuff. But my background is documentary, and I've produced and shot and directed a dozen documentaries and have won several Emmys for them. But what I am excited about is, and I think you mentioned a little bit of this, and I lived in L.A. too, so we'll have to swap some L.A. stories, but is doing a VR type of documentary. So I would really like to partner with somebody here who knows more about programming than I do. I can bring my documentary chops to the project, but I'm not much of a programmer, so I would like to talk to somebody who's potentially interested in some sort of a project with a documentary feel to it in VR.
There's a journalist that's doing something, doing documentary work, journalistic documentary.
Yes, yeah, I'm familiar with a lot of that. The you're absolutely right. There's some stuff in, is it Afghanistan or Syria? There's
New York Times is actually sending a new one out about every month.
Yeah, right, that's true too, yeah. And that was the biggest. That was the biggest implementation because they sent out cardboard with the New York Times, right? By the millions, right? Yeah. So.
But they're also making content.
Yeah, right. But yeah. So I'm interested in doing that. And I also have a few brochures on what it is we actually do here in the lab, if you're interested. And I guess Alan, are you going to talk to you and give them the pitch about what we do here? So that's me, and welcome to the VTL Lab. That stands for Virtual Theatricality Lab. So it's like ATM. Right, ATM, you always say ATM machine, and there's an M there. The BTL lab, the L is lab, but okay, get out. Oh, good news, pizza showed up. And the Mexican food was for my students earlier. There is some leftover of that, so you can have leftover Mexican and now pizza, whatever you want.
Yeah, so I guess we'll let Alan go ahead and give his introduction now.
Alan Contino, I designed this space. I'm the chief engineer for Virtual Theatricality, the form of stagecraft invented by Dr. Popovich here at the school. 80s, 90s, I was a member of MPEG. I was one of the E's of MPEG. And I worked in broadcast engineering for a while before specializing in stereoscopic presentation, which is when I started working here. And we've been working under several grants to create a virtual theatricality system. But all the grant money's running out, and we have no prototype to speak of, so I'm looking for work. That's everything in a nutshell, and at some point, I think maybe after we eat, we'll demo the whole lab and show you what we've got going on here.
They most recently did Dinosaurus.
The virtual theatricality stage production.
Yeah.
So that's, we're instead of doing virtual reality head-mounted, we've been doing augmented virtual reality for the stage and for large theater systems. Settings. And virtual theatricality process has caught on. It's based on what's been done in the theme parks since the 80s with, Terminator ride or the, Shrek attractions, various different things at Disney Universal Studios. They've all jumped on the bandwagon. We're all doing. And it's become pretty standard now for entertainment that the digital world is always combined with live production. There's really no time you don't see the two ever merging anymore. And we wanted to create a system that was marketable and travel, so we could travel, do road shows and everything like that. But like I said, the grant money's all gone. And what we ended up with was everything that's in this lab. And so we're able to teach classes with it, but unfortunately we don't have a virtual theatricality system yet. It's still yet to be just made.
Who have been the funding partners?
Hmm?
Who have the grants come through previously?
They were done through the grant application process through the college.
Okay.
And a good portion of it had come from Ford Motor Company because they tend to be the one that grants us. For proximity, we're right here and we're training future engineers, so it always happens that way. But there was a couple other funding sources besides that. But the school managed the grant process because we are at the school. We have to go through them.
Dark money, you don't want
to. So just one comment going up with Alan, and we'll see what he's kind of talking about. If you wanted to, we looked at a video a couple of meetings ago that kind of reminded me about the virtual reality, augmented reality, kind of cross between the two. They took a school bus and turned it into a virtual reality school bus where it kind of tracked them open to the bus and all the windows turned from clear windows into Mars. So you were kind of driving around Mars and it was recording your space and stopping and starting when you were stopping and starting. It was really cool stuff.
Huh.
Yeah.
Is that part of a Google Classroom?
No, this wasn't a Google one. I'll try and find them, like, share it either on the page or up here tonight. But yeah, really, really cool technology. But yeah, why don't we got pizza getting cold over here and Mexican food even colder, so why don't we take about 10 minutes and take a little break, grab some food, and then we'll come back. I got a 10-minute presentation, and then we'll go ahead and get into virtual theatricality lab.
If you have
your motion capture 1, 2, and 3.
I guess
stereoscopic class, a green screen class, a visual effects class. The school offers a visual effects certificate. And to get the visual effects certificate, you have to take mocap and green screen and several other classes. I mentioned those brochures. They're over here, I think.
Well, apparently, when they put in the new projector, we didn't get the right connections on this guy for component. So I just have to draw your attention to the screens.
So what we have is, has anybody seen the Shrek on stage? Disney World? Disneyland?
The play?
The amusement park attraction.
Oh, yeah. I know.
No? Nobody's seen that? Yeah. Has anybody done the Terminator ride at Universal Studios?
The one's been out for a while.
yeah. Since the 90s, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
So the idea, Edwin, can you start these guys up? So as you're going through the Terminator ride, there's cameras and projectors, both, through the ride. And they're tracking the audience ride through the game, right through the attraction. Right? And as the cameras follow the car that's traveling through the ride, the projectors follow that person's perspective and gives them a projection around them of the same thing in 3D. So you have to wear polarized glasses, and they're using circular polarized glasses. And so as you ride through the ride, the 3D perspective of what's in front of you around the ride changes with your own perspective as you ride through it. So the cameras are tracking the movement of the cars so that each car and each set of seats can have the right perspective and convergence for when the projection is shown as they ride through. Right? And that's how they're able to give you all the in-your-face gimmicks and whatnot. Right? So similar to that, the virtual theatricality idea is that if you have a small audience that's a little bit deeper than it is wide, you can place everyone in front of an immersive 180-degree surround system that's rear projected in 3D. From the rear projection in 3D, we can map the projections so that it appears that the object coming off the screen are standing in front of the screen. So we have an array, you have a center set of stereo and a left and right set of stereo. And between these six projectors, we map the 3D space and it gives you a surround 3D immersive environment that you can see with the 3D glasses. So we're able to set a convergence point that's no longer the screen. Our convergence point is the point in front of the screen where the end of the curve, the 180 curve, ends, right? So we have a nice depth space to work with that is a regular stage space within that surround. Then we take, so we're projecting in 3D all of that stuff in that space, and then a live actor can stand next to that projection and the audience can see them interact. So we're projecting, say, a monster, like a, you know, say like an alien. And that alien appears to the audience wearing 3D glasses that they're standing next to the person. And they can play their scene live and in real time. So the person controlling the alien is actually in the mocap stage, wearing a mocap suit. And in front of the audience in the theater is the projection of that alien that they're controlling. So the alien is a puppet that's projected on stage in immersive 3D, and next to them is a live person. And so their interaction happens in real time because the person in the mocap suit in the studio can see and interact via telepresence the live person on stage. And they can hear each other, they can see each other, so they can play off each other and play the scene.
Or the audience too, right? So you can say, hey, you with the hat, how are you
exactly.
doing?
Exactly, they can interact with the audience. So the person in the mocap environment, in the mocap stage, can not only see the actors on stage that he's telepresencing with, but he can also see the audience and interact with the audience. Okay, and that's the biggest part of the gimmick for Disney is with the Shrek ride or the Shrek attraction. And they do Monsters, Inc. at Disney World of Florida, they do Monsters, Inc. where they actually have 3D projections of monsters from Monsters, Inc. come out on stage and then talk to the kids directly, one-on-one.
And they can reflect like what they're wearing, in other words, they can make it.
Right, yeah, they make it live and entertaining.
Exactly, live.
And it relies on the actor in the mocap suit to be a good comedian and good with kids so that they can bring out and embellish the performance, right? So only part of it's scripted, a lot of it relies on improv. So we take that one step further. So now if you can imagine, we have the immersive projection of an alien standing next to me. I'm live on stage. The alien pulls a lightsaber. Everyone knows what a lightsaber is, I hope? So now I, as a live on stage actor, I have a motion sensor in my hand that's connected to the system. And with my motion sensor, then that activates my own lightsaber. So now the audience can see a 3D projection of a lightsaber emitting from my hand. And because it's a motion sensor, I can track wherever that my hand moves, and the lightsaber projection follows it. Now myself and the alien can have a lightsaber duel live on stage and interactive with the audience.
What kind of motion sensor would you be using when your hand is magnetic?
Well, we have used the magnetic, yeah, but ideally we wanted to use an inertial system. So we have wireless inertial tracking, much, much better streamlined, and a little bit more wireless. Right, yeah, yeah. So the
magnetic systems are wireless too, but the inertial systems are much more accurate because they're using both inertia and magnetic.
For trying to mention the Sid show?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Has anybody seen Sid the Science Kid? Sid the Science
Kid? Okay, you can admit
it. It's running on PBS right now. It's by the Jim Henson Company. And it is the first live television show, or recorded live, I should say, that uses virtual theatricality. So when they got the idea from us for virtual theatricality, the Jim Henson Company had the money to invest in a system similar to ours and actually do a TV show. So every week they have at least 3 or 4 television shows that they're recording live in the studio. So they have all their actors are wearing motion capture puppet suits. And what is recorded in real time is the virtual version of all the kids. So what you see in the TV show is a 3D animation cartoon. But those characters in that cartoon are all driven by actual actors in the Jim Henson Studio. And it's all recorded in real time. Every episode is recorded live in front of a studio audience and then played back for regular commercial television around the world, right? So that's the virtual theatricality concept and idea. And so we have in this room is where all the testing motion capture takes place. So we have the motion capture behind set up with 9 cameras surrounding me. And they're infrared cameras, so we need to increase the red light so that the red reflectivity is kind of exemplified. And that's why we don't have the big overheads on or anything, because we want to maintain this level of red in the scene so that anything that reflects red can be seen by the cameras. And these are 4K infrared cameras, and they all have a red LED ring to emit around the lens, a spectrum of red, right? And you can see we have a couple different models. These other models are a little newer. They have a full red emitters, whereas the other ones have a partial red emitter. Partial was good enough. At some point, it was okay, but we actually learned through the development processes that our cameras
that if you had a full red and more red light in the scene, that they're much better. And so you get much better data without having to have a higher resolution camera. And they have since replaced these with higher resolution cameras. They're basically doing a 12K system now. So they have 12K cameras. And they're much more portable. They're using them a lot more for outdoor capture now. It's an active system. What we have is a passive system. So this is passive in that it's only recording what's reflected. The markers, hey Scott, the markers are literally just rubber.
Scott, one of our students.
So these are just rubber.
He dresses like that every day.
Yeah, you all dress too. Pretty good.
Yeah.
Great Halloween.
So these are really literally just rubber circles. And they have 3M reflective tape glued and stretched over top to make them reflective. And the cheapest way to do it, just by using the tape.
It's really cool.
So it's you know, model glue and pieces, you know, formed to stretch over to create the ball. And we have these larger balls that we're using, which are almost full circles, except for where they're attached to the body. And so the more bulbous, the more circularity they have, the easier they are to see, right? And so what I want to do is, let's do the 3D demonstration here first.
So there are a total of 53 markers for our system. And if Scott was to take the suit off, please don't, but if he did, the markers would stay on the suit, but when somebody else or even Scott put the suit on again, the markers would need to be moved to their proper space, right? If you'll notice, they're on joints, right? They're places where things bend. That's where we want to capture the motions largely. 53 and counting the head marker. And I mentioned at least one young man, the cameras with tags are celebrity cameras.
Yeah.
Because these, we actually bought these from LA. These cameras were used for Polar Express. So the cameras that have the tags on them, at one point, were pointed on Tom Hanks, and now they're pointed on Scott.
Was the
character
from the site from 15 years ago, was that the same kind of basic technology?
Yeah.
We've got a couple of things.
All right.
So I guess I got
another one.
Is it working? Is it,
yeah,
it is.
Yeah. Oh, there you go. That's from
our last stage production. And so if you can imagine, on stage we had a 40-foot long curved screen that was 22 feet high. So this guy is King King. This is our character King King the T-Rex. King King appeared live on stage holographically as a 15-foot size T-Rex. And on stage, you can see the immersion effect happening if you get the parallax. And of course, everybody looks side to side. When this is projected on stage, of course, at scale, with a curved screen immersively, and I stand next to this guy, it looks like we're standing in the same suit. So if he tilts his head down, he's going to hit me, right?
We had small children running for the exits.
Yeah, we took it a little further, too. We did a little 4D effects.
Yeah.
Where in one of the scenes, we have all these little critters that kind of come running through the cave and out at the audience. And underneath all of the seats, we had ticklers that were grabbing the ankles of all the kids. So that as the critters roll out, right, they grab all their feet.
And
everybody just screams in terror.
Isn't there water too being splashed?
Right. Well, yeah, King King actually, when he first comes out, he's sick in the scene. And he sneezes, and the entire audience gets showered with water.
Oh. It's like a Gallagher concert.
Right. And the kids, you know, they really bought it. Hook, line, and sinker. They thought they could run up and touch King King because of the immersion and because of the perspective of 3D that's happening.
Tell me you didn't do a scratch.
No. Smell-o-vision? No smell-o-vision.
Yeah, we did have a scene though where the Triceratops is supposed to fart, but it got cut out.
We're a public school after all.
Yeah, we are a public school. So that's the whole concept in a nutshell. And so we'll give you a little show here now of, we'll play a little bit of it. Is the audio on?
So this is an actor, right?
Hmm?
You guys was an actor.
Partially, yeah. We did some captures for King King with an actor. In the interest of time, this actually took 4 years to produce, so.
Woo!
In the interest of time, the end of
the day. I must be getting old. Kevin McKay's a lousy dunkhead. I gotta eat something. Even a lousy pterodactyl sounds good.
So that was the sneeze we were talking about, okay.
Hey!
We had to significantly downscale it to fit this projector for this room, right? But it's so the convergence and the immersion doesn't quite work on a flat screen. It doesn't look as good as you, when you have it, you know, full scale. Because this render, these stereoscopic renders, were rendered specifically for the stage space.
Tell them about the render time.
Oh yeah, this was a 26 months to render. And it was a 45-minute show. So it took 26 months in rendering, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, with 3 computers.
Don't make any mistakes.
Right, yeah. So, yeah, to present something that large on stage in an immersive screen was really high-resolution requirements. So everything was done 60 frames per second, and all of the images were 4K. We projected them in 2K. To give a really good, you know, quality look. And that's why, you know, the effect is so stunning when you have the immersive screen around you, that the correlation between the live action and the fake. And so the trick, too, is with stage lighting, to light the actual actors that are in the scene to complement the image that's surrounding them in 3D, so that the color palette has to be very specific for every scene, for every part of the cave, had to be designed so that the live on stage actors looked like they were lit by that environment.
This young man, Ellen, had a question about the render.
Yeah, are you using GPUs or CPU processing or mixture of both?
We were using box systems. It was a package with 12 cores and 128 gig of RAM. There was 6 GPUs on each system. They were, each package was about 10 grand.
So was the final hopeful project something you could take around to different stages, like you could show it in Detroit, show it in Cleveland?
Exactly, right. We wanted, the ultimate prototype we want to develop would be a suitcase studio. So it would be everything that's in this room, basically in suitcases that could be plugged into any theatrical environment. And it works ideally with black box situations, okay? So if you have a room that you can make completely black, you know, it's like a cave system, then it would work ideally for that type of situation because, you know, half of the room has to become the projection space and the other half of the room has to become the audience. And you need to control all the light. You have to have complete control of all light. And that's, you know, that's the thing about theater and the drawback of what you see for large group entertainment is you have to be able to light for the audience, but you also have to be able to light for your presentation. So we're subject to reality and everything.
And exit signs, fire hazard.
Yeah, exactly. So there's things like, you know, we had to create certain aisles so that the exit signs were blacked to the audience and their light was controlled. But then if you walk down the aisle, you could still see the exit to do the fire. You know, so all of those concerns have to be taken into account, which is why, like at Universal Studios or Walt Disney World, they're creating these
buildings that have everything controlled inside. Once you take the ride, everything's controlled once you enter. Right?
Who did the modeling, or what?
That was I did all the compositing and stereoscopics, and my partner on it was a guy named Chris Dozier who did the artwork.
Like those mushrooms.
Yeah.
So there are very few schools, especially schools this size, that teach motion capture. I think Alan mentioned, that there might be 12 schools.
It's not the entire planet.
That's right. 12 schools on the planet? So there you go, yeah. So there's not very many schools at all that teach motion capture, much less a school. This is a rather small school, as you know. And we're proud. We used to be Henry Ford Community College, but we kicked out the community. They now offer a four-year degree in nursing or something, so now it's at least in some respects a Henry Ford College. So now the short name is actually Henry Ford College.
Right, if you take pictures, make sure the flash is on.
That's exactly right. If your flash is... We don't allow flash photography during the mocap session, as you might imagine, because it wreaks havoc with the cameras. But for this kind of situation, you may want the flash on because it'll give you a nice glow in the markers. Yeah.
Yeah, alright, so we want to set up our reference.
We've heard from students that a picture of yourself in a mocap suit on your Facebook page goes a long way with the ladies. I don't know if it's true, but that's what we had some students.
I mean, the outfit is flattering.
Oh, just by the way, Scott is too
perhaps timid or shy, but
Scott is an accomplished combat choreographer.
Did I get that correct?
Yeah.
So works on movies and TV doing fight choreography.
Okay, so here you get the side-by-side view of the live person and what he's doing in the virtual space for his virtual counterpart. So the virtual counterpart has no body. He has only markers determining what is the right side. Red is always right. So we have red right side and green left side with blue spinal cord and yellow center markers. So here's the T-pose. Right, see? And
these are cameras, right? These are our cameras.
Those are the virtual representation of where the cameras are placed in the studio. And so as we record, we get the reference camera over here, which is the live action camera, right?
This is necessary sometimes because if you get occlusion with a marker, let's say Scott's doing something and he covers up his own markers or another actor in the scene, if it was in fact a fight, you can imagine the amount of occlusion you're going to get with two people, right, with the occlusion being the covering, the obscuring of the markers. Then we go to the reference video to see, oh, that's the problem. He had his hand in front of this marker or his foot or his face or whatever. So the reference, there's a practical reason, you know, we use. It doesn't end up in the final project unless you're doing a making of or a breakdown. Then they would use some of this footage. But it's largely, as it's called, reference. Where the problem occurred with the markers, if in fact there was a problem.
Can you tell us a little about the software that you're using?
This is the Vicon system is who makes all the cameras and the interface system for this, and what you're looking at on the screen is Blade. And it used to be called IQ. A long time ago when it first started, and Vicon's been the biggest company that's sold this to everybody. A lot of the studios for gaming and motion picture television production have proprietary systems that they don't sell to the public. So it's very similar systems, but they're proprietary, so nobody can ever touch them unless you work for that company, right? And so Vicon's one of them that didn't go that direction. They allowed everything to be sold for the general public. So you can just go on their website, you can buy your own system. They're very expensive, though.
That's why we got these ones used, because they were half off, right? So, and so let's see,
half off was still a couple grand, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah, totally. Half off was still at least $2,500. So we have these two from Polar Express, and These other two were from, what was that movie with Steve Buscemi's? Monster House. Monster House? Anybody see Monster House?
Yeah. I liked it.
Steve Buscemi. And we almost got the ones used on Beowulf, but they sold before we could order them. So, as you can see, I'm invisible. But I'm covering up his markers. Right?
See the occlusion occurring, the flickering when Alan steps in front of the markers, right?
So that's the problem with a passive system, in that these are just rubber balls that are reflecting, is that we don't have anything to tell the system, once they're covered up, where they went. Right? So once they're covered up, you know, all the data is missing, it's gone. That doesn't exist in the system anymore. If we have an active system, and an active system would replace these markers with red LED lights. And so if each one had a red LED light, it could also be wired to a tracking system so that as long as the red light is on, the system knows where it's at. So you don't have to worry about occlusion anymore because the red light's still lit even when you cover it up. Those are, of course, much more expensive systems. They're very popular now. They use them on, you know, Rise of the Planet of the Apes. And wherever a movie or a game had to shoot outdoors, they're using the active system instead of the passive system.
Oh, I put them back.
Oh, yeah.
Instead
of
interfere with the lights.
Do they have anything like ultrasonic systems or anything like that, where those are actually like hanging, you know, sort of like what GPS does?
That's like the inertia system, yeah.
Okay.
The inertia system uses a combination of magnetic inertia and accelerometer. And so when you position it, you're telling the system what your origin north is, and so then it ultrasonically calibrates with the three different types of sensors. It coordinates from all of those sensors one point in space, and then gives that back to the system. And that is the leading system right now that uses that technology is called XENS. It's XSENS. And you know, so they require no cameras because it's strictly a prosthetic system that you wear that has all of the inertia sensors on it.
Rotation and translation.
Right. So you get rotation and translation data directly to a laptop wirelessly, and so they can capture soccer players playing soccer through the entire soccer field without loss of any data or markers. But you can imagine those suits are pretty expensive, right? They compare to at least two of these cameras. If not more.
So talk to maybe about props and why that see-through element.
So yeah, one thing, because this is a passive system, like Mr. G said, the we only get translation data. And does everybody know what I mean by that?
In a 3D environment, your 3D programmers, I'm sure, do, right? You're not your handy 3D programmer.
So if I have translation, I know where this is moving in space. Up, down, left, and right, okay? But I don't know how these glasses are oriented, right? I don't know.
Drone pilots, they know about that, right?
Right? Yeah. So if it's oriented this way, and I'm moving around, I need rotation data to know that where these glasses are facing, right? The orientation for pitch, yaw, and roll, right? Mm-hmm. So with this passive system, we're only recording translation data. In that we know where the markers are moving in space, we don't know how they're oriented in space. So we have to solve and translate that in real time. We do retargeting translation to the skeletons. So if you see inside his body, inside the marker cloud, he's got this red and these red and blue bones.
Do you want to reconstruct it so you can see the bones?
His head one's back there, right?
Oh yeah. So to turn the go to reconstruct. Right, so you see here's his skeleton down at the bottom.
Right.
Right, and it's just kind of hanging out at point zero. And so those are his bones. So what we're doing is we're solving his point cloud of translation data into rotation data that can control these bones. So the bones inside his body now are acting as a puppet, right? And so the translation points are pulling that puppet, just like a marionette does. They're pulling those bones with the puppet into place so that the bones themselves have the rotation data for us. They know how to run. Cool? And I don't know what we should do.
Well, props. Can you explain props?
Yeah. So the
You should see this guy, yeah.
And just to say, as a teacher, almost every student, not 100%, but most students, they want to have a bath. Right? That's all they want to do. And so it's problematic because with two actors, you get a lot of obscuring. For a beginning mocap student, that's a lot of cleaning up of bad marker data because of the occlusion that occurs. So they get a little bit bummed out or depressed or, you know, irritated at the amount of cleaning. So when they first start out, right, we try and say one character, you know what I mean, and then we can bring other characters
in. By the end of third semester, I'll have
these. Oh, well, also separately, this is mocap one, for example. We do face capture, and if you think this might be annoying, try 32 on your face, right? He already said he would, but you have to be clean shaven.
Also, we're not demoing for you today is the face or the fingers.
Right.
These have no finger control right now because we're not doing anything for the fingers.
No detail of the hand at all.
Yeah, right? It requires that the cameras be mounted a different way so that we can actually get a lot of the digits, the motion of the digits. We have everything mounted up so that we can use the space here and we can all be here.
And we have gloves that they literally plug into their own machine locally, USB, and do a hand capture with the gloves. So if the scene calls for him, I'm sorry, Scott, calls him to grab the shield in the body capture, he would do the grab part, you know what I mean, in a broad way like this, and then we would do a separate capture to get the hand clasp, and then that hand clasp is blended with the other body capture, right? So you end up blending. Yeah, Al's got the gloves. You end up blending face capture, body capture, and hand capture.
So these are pretty interesting. As prosthetic system goes, these have a linear arrangement of sensors that line each knuckle. You can just pass this around.
They're crazy expensive, too.
Yeah. So as you put these gloves on, it has this is basically just a rubber tube that lines the edge of your knuckle. And within that rubber tube is a series of sensors who are calibrated in relation to each other. So it's kind of like a worm, right? So as the worm bends, we know what the translation data is between that for that bend of the knuckle, right? And so we have a sensor for every knuckle on the hand for all five digits, and that way we're able to create all of the intricate movement via USB data for the fingers.
And what is that resistance value?
It is. It's inductive resistance. Yeah, actually, it's inductive resistance. Yeah. So you actually have a coil in the tube. And you have a, right. If you can imagine it from electrical engineering, how it's arranged, it's inductive resistance tube that can follow the bend and give it, and it equates to serial data. It's real basic serial data. In fact, when these gloves came out, it was before USB. So the initial version of these
USB one, right?
Were actually serial data ports. They were 9-pin serial data ports. All of this stuff predates modern technology. In fact, our magnetic system relies on ISA cards. I don't know if anybody remembers ISA cards. So all of the sensors for the prosthetic system we have in magnetic sensors run through ISA cards, and it's on a very old limited machine too. And that can actually capture
running XP probably, right?
Not even Windows XP. And the interesting thing about that is, it's being such an old system, it can capture real-time data of the entire prosthetic suit, all 12 sensors, really well with only 2 gig of RAM and a. Yeah, I think it's a 686 processor.
Is that
what Essential? Essential.
Yeah, Essential, exactly.
So very limited processor, very nice ISA cards, and an ISA card for each sensor. So there's 12 ISA cards mounted on a motherboard with 686, and then it processes everything as serial data, right, through, and so it all predates USB.
But as old as that system is, the benefit, and why some students prefer it for certain things, is that you get the rotation and translation data, and there's no obscuring of any markers, because there is no markers. So when it comes, you know, for those kind of fights or, you know, trip and fall or something where you might fall on a marker, and believe me, you don't want to fall on one of these, right? But, and it would also damage the marker. So the prosthetic is often a better choice for certain more physical types of capture. And again, why is this like this? Anybody has any guess? This is a shield. Kind of obvious, but why is this open here? Besides so you can see me. Exactly, not included. There you go.
So when he puts his arm through, you can still see all the arm markers. And we don't lose solving on his arm when he uses
the shield. So do the stance. There you go.
It's a nice pose.
So we don't have the props actually in this particular demo scene.
I'm sure you all know this, but I mean, they get LeBron James, throw crazy money at him because he's kind of a broke guy, right? They throw crazy money at him, get him in the suit, so that's why when you play NBA, you know, 2K or whatever, that's why, you know, he moves exactly like LeBron, because it was LeBron.
So now, this is Ascension Motion, Autodesk Motion Builder.
You have to turn to the
here.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, he's going to get rid of his props, and we're going to resolve them.
Now, Motion Builder, you can find tutorials on YouTube on Motion Builder. The program's a little bit more common than Blade. So there's a fair amount of YouTube tutorials on mobile, as we call it, Motion Builder. But not really much up on, not much on Blade. But if you had Blade, you'd also have to have the cameras to have it work.
So this is our 3D model. He's an old game character from the early 90s called Gaunt. He's an alien traveler, explorer, and he's actually got a map wrapped up on his back. Turn around for us to see your back. So he's got a big map, like a treasure map, that's on his back there. And so he's supposed to be like a friendly alien. And so this is, you know, the 3D model is just another puppet, right? So this is a puppet being controlled in real time by the motion data. And apparently we just lost his hand because he's been covered up.
So it resembles Scott a great deal.
All right, so now let's wiggle your hands a little bit. Let's see if we... Yeah, there we go. That wrist seems to be a little broken. Maybe those marks...
So yeah, that's caused... See that irregular? That
those marks
bad
might be a little dirty. Yeah. They're not reflecting as much, so we're getting a little weirdness in his hand there, right? So now you can imagine if we're projecting this on stage, right, as a live character in 3D, it looks pretty impressive. And so this is, you know, basically what everybody's going for right now is real time. There's all sorts of new companies coming out with their own real-time mocap systems, so that you can do this, streamline all of your production in real-time with real cameras. And so just like you saw the props, because they have markers, of course, you can see them in the 3D space. We do that with the cameras as well. When you put markers around the camera, we can travel the camera through the 3D space and track the camera as well. So then the camera that is being tracked in the 3D space, that image can then be processed in Motion Builder or Maya or the 3D application of your choice so that you get real-time mapping data of your environment from the camera along with your 3D.
Was your camera doing that in Avatar or not?
Yes, yeah, in Avatar they did that a lot in the movie Avatar.
Actually, he had the screen right here in his hand.
Yeah, handheld.
So he
was able to see the composite with.
They mounted a little, 5-inch HD display to his tracking camera rig so that he could see, you know, at his own monitor what was coming from the computer. So he was lining up his shot with the 3D environment, you know, as opposed to watching the virtual environment.
Yeah, he didn't have to imagine it. He saw it as it was ultimately going to be.
Cool. So let's see if there's something fantastic. You're just standing there. Maybe we need some music so you can dance.
Oh, here's an interesting little. One of our students brought in a belly dancer, a real belly dancer, and she had the prosthetic system. And what I mean by real, I mean a real talented belly dancer. So the marker data of like her hips was just astounding. I mean, you know, go make me do it.
But you know, as a real belly dancer, it was really something to see that data, because you could really sway those hips. And you couldn't animate that if your life depended on it to get that natural sway of a real set of hips, right? So.
Yeah,
that's right. So this guy in scale, he's actually like 12 feet tall.
Yeah.
And you can see his arms and hands are like considerably longer than human perspective, right? And his feet are like crazy big too.
Was it like lift up my hands on my hips, I had to be up here? Yeah.
Yeah, so he has an unusually small waist, by the way, too.
It's like
he's totally alien because nobody could have a waist that size. Yeah, lift up your foot so you see the feet a little bit there. It's a giant, huge, crazy feet, right? And really long. And he actually has a fifth digit there. So if we capture with this, turn around and see if we can see that toe, that thumb toe, right?
Yeah.
So if we do capture for this guy, we actually have to do hand capture for the feet, right? Because he has that opposable thumb in his foot that he could use, so we need to make use of that.
And right? The weird thing is,
so if you can imagine now, we're going to combine this. I'll take this one step further. In this lab, what the lab is designed for, why we have such a large control system right there, is in the tall black rack, we have what's basically called a television suitcase studio. And so in that rack is a television production switcher. So it has a technical director would be able to choose any source, right? So we have live cameras. We have the 3D sources, we have the motion builder source, we have the Vicon source, we have all those sources going through one master system. And we can switch and we can mix all of those systems. So if we were to light the green screen and roll out the green, we can, in real time, composite with green screen, just like the weatherman does, a person into the 3D environment to interact with him in 3D. And we don't just do it like the weatherman. The weatherman's in 2D, right? He has one camera on. So I have set up over here, if you haven't seen it yet, we have our very crude 3D camera rig.
Right next to that.
So we have a stereoscopic camera rig. Yeah. So what we do is...
Van and White that thing over there.
So we shoot the live people in front of the green screen in stereo. And so when they interact in the 3D environment with the 3D virtual character, they are also in 3D. So we've matched the 3D virtual perspective with the CGI elements that are controllable in real time. And now we can marry those with somebody who's on green screen in stereoscopics to that same environment. Everybody follow? That makes sense, right? And then we can project all of that back onto stage. So the audience sees the person in the studio on green, the virtual characters, and then the live action characters all interacting in real time on stage in 3D. And then, of course, if they have props or they have lightsabers, you know, that everybody can interact with those. One of the first uses of the augmented interactivity we did was with a person on stage, they had a motion sensor in their hand. We had projection areas of virtual props. So we had an actual table and lined up on stage with the actual table. We had the virtual version of the table coming off of it. So the table looked much deeper than it actually was in the real space. And when the live actor came next to that table, there was a coffee mug on the table. And when he grabbed that virtual coffee mug, he hit the button on his sensor so it attached to his hand, and then he could drink from the virtual mug and then set the mug back down and release it. So then we take that even further. We can say, well, we're going to fill up that mug with anything from the virtual world and make it any size we want to, and he can still grab that new giant mug and drink whatever's out of it. So a lot of interactivity, a lot of augmentation happening for the audience.
Virtual beer and So is this something that you can still do or in terms of going around the schools or going to programs, or you don't have to pay?
We can demonstrate a lot of this to schools, but there is no system. You know, the system has never been built because we ran out of grant money. So we've applied for a couple new grants and we haven't got it. So we're kind of in the lurch right now.
But the time you were talking about earlier, I guess whenever you demoed it or what, like when was that?
That was for
Dinosaurs?
Dinosaurs. Yeah.
That was a live stage production, yeah. That was $15 a ticket.
Yeah.
You know, we ran for 2 months, you know, live stage production.
Sold out every night, right?
Yeah.
But so you still could reboot that?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, sure. Yeah, that part of it can always be reboot. The interactivity and the other virtual theatricality elements of making everything augmented and interactive is the part that we can't necessarily demo because, you know, that technology is part of the system that doesn't exist anymore. Right? So it can be done with various different systems, right? But that means adding another computer to the control system and then doing that portion, right? So right now, in the system here, we have the tower, which is the TV studio portion that has all the signals to control and to combine everything. We have the audio system, which we can't really record audio in here too much because the computers make so much noise. But we can wire that to another room where we have audio recording. And of course, we have it wired to the stage. So then we have the director's station where he can see on screen the composite, the preview before the composite, and then the post-composite version of the final on his program monitor. Next to that is the Vicon motion capture desk, where we're controlling the Vicon system. At that desk, we also have the face system computer at that screen. So we have two screens, one's face, one's body. Next to that, we have the motion capture system for the real-time motion capture display that you see here, right? So the motion building portion. Next to that, we have a finger system to do the finger computer. So we can have the fingers running on another monitor for another system. Then we have next to that the stereoscopic system. So each station, if we were to run a fully interactive production, we would actually have six people back there, all running eight different computers to make the whole thing work. And the final station is the 3D stereoscopic station, where we have a monitor set up to use shutter glasses so that they can preview what the 3D is looking like, and they can control the convergence and the mapping of the 3D projection space so that when we send it to the audience, we know that it works well and they can see it properly. We also have our link that goes all the way through the building to our theater and then comes back. So we have it's six Cat6 connections so that we can connect digitally everything in the room to everything on stage. Control everything on stage via this room, etc. And the so between the theater system and this room, the whole system becomes one big area.
So we could put on an entire production in the theater from this room.
Right. And interact both ways, back and forth, depending on where you want the actors, where the scene falls for the actors. And that's the idea, is to put all of that into one box. You know, we have two computers that run the whole thing. And you know, then you can wheel that around to any theater, you know, do any type of virtual theatricality production for anything.
And we're doing this in some cases with 17-year-old kids that have been out of high school for 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Right? You know what I mean? So it's...
Yeah, the student body we've had is very diverse. You know, we start with 16, 17, we go all...
We get some students right now that still are in high school. We get those combos.
Right, yeah. They're dual enrollment students that are still in high school.
30.
Yeah, he's 30.
And we also have the geezers, people my age, that have retired, come back to school, auto workers that have retired, a lot of military, you know, that come here. So
well, last year we had Michael, who's nearly 70.
Yeah. And he was our most energetic student.
Oh, yeah, right.
That's random a few minutes ago. Yeah, so we get seniors, you know, people my age.
He's become a movement actor now. He's really good, physically fit to move. He has a really good movement act. So he's working with one of our instructors who's a protege of Professor Marceau. And he's learning, you know, movement acting.
So we have time for one last question. Anybody has a last quick one to throw out there?
Automotive really loves it.
The cave they have
over here at Fort Water Company is
really cool in that they're trying to do a similar approach to what we're doing with combining the motion capture elements of a person interacting with a vehicle.
Right.
And so the testing procedures and the experience of the driver goes to a whole new level, because you can immerse the driver in the driving experience for that virtual car that doesn't exist yet.
The way a woman gets onto a truck, let's say an F-150, the way that she steps up and gets on that truck is different than, you might not know this, but it's different than the way a man does it, right? So it really lets you study the anatomy and the movements. Just a brief story. My sister was part of a butt study. Somehow she would sign up for all these surveys, and the whole study was how your butt fits in a car seat. You know, I mean, she was paid, I don't know how much money for her butt. But they actually, so, you know, I don't think that was mocap, but they do use mocap to see how people get in and out of vehicles, right?
Virtual interactivity is a mainstay for engineering design. I don't think there's any, you know, company unlike Ford that's not getting into that and trying to do it.
And one of our exam questions, by the way, is where was the origin of mocap? And we'll just see how good a student this guy is. What was the origin of mocap? There you go, great student. But yeah, so it started out as a medical analysis tool, right? In fact,
70s, right. In the early 70s is when motion capture started in medical science.
Some of the nomenclature is left over. Isn't some of the file names like
that? Oh, yeah. Well, the BVH, the Biovision Hierarchy System, is the original data hierarchy for translation rotation data of the human body. And it's still
the
used
BVH
today. It's still basic. It's the world, or the universal interchangeable file format for all of motion in animation. And in CAD, in basically anything that needs motion translation for translation.
Just do a brief walk.
Of human body, of biological people.
It might be hard with this particular model, but if he did have a deficiency in his walk, whatever it is, you can see how analyzing, you know, the data as just a point cloud or something would get very specific and see, you know, what's causing the pain or the.
And I don't know, you might be able to see it if it's big enough. So you do the flexing of your muscles here. So you see that we have flexor response in the muscle tissue for the bending of the arms there, right? So and that's pretty standard now in all of kinesiology. Kinesiology study is basically attaching motion sensors to all of the muscle areas. They're going to do where the ligaments and tendons attach to the muscle, and then they're going to do an array through the muscle, and then they're going to track all of that muscle movement and how it relates to that person's bone structure, and they're going to be able to create a very specific, definitive way to create physical therapy for that patient.
And there's some interesting stuff being done at a much lower scale, but with Kinect, right? The Xbox Kinect, right? There's a lot of stuff on YouTube where they're attempting mocap by using the Kinect, and we have a couple Kinect systems. We do have one for the face.
We've used the Kinect for face and body, and the drawback of the Kinect, of course, is that it's one point of view, and it's limited to just translation information. So there's no rotation solving. There's nothing else going on besides that one field of view. Is anybody familiar with the Kinect? Most people are. It's a sensor, and it has stereoscopic display, but you can only see that one stereo view and follow anything that's within that one view.
It knows when you walk in the room.
Whereas this system is 360. Right? It's entirely immersion depth.
What is your question?
Wrapping up with you guys. Work.
Totally, yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, I wanted to thank you so much for inviting us out here. Gem hiding over here. I had no idea until you invited us. So
great tour.
Getting a little bit late here, so we're gonna go ahead and do our drawings for our headsets.
Who's gonna pick up these glasses?
Somebody will be coming around.
You don't have to draw your
own.
Who does not have a card in here?
How about this?
You want to eliminate me?
Yes.
Oh, thank you. I'm a teacher. You want to
eliminate me? It's, here. All right.
Here's here.
So the volume at that point is rather limited, but you get to get your location at risk. And you can fall in trouble if you're there.
All right, I want to point out that if you know somebody who's making a product like this, you call them up or you email them and you say, listen, we got 300 people out here who might be interested in getting a demo of your product, and we'll do this and we'll raffle it off, and the person who wins them gets it next week. So this
but
is
where's the rip?
Huh?
If that's true, where's the rip? Yeah.
It's coming, back next week.
Anyway, so...
Yeah, and this is VR kicks, so if you don't win tonight and you need a VR headset, definitely go and buy a VR kick, sir.
Okay, the winner of the first one is...
Sultan.
Say the name, say the name!
Sultan Shabri.
So we put his card back in so he can win too? The winner of number two is...
Gunther?
Oh.
Yeah.
There you go. The last final one is.
Yes. John Braps.
That was the easiest $15 I ever made.
So thanks for coming out. I was going to give a little presentation, but it's getting late. I want to give everybody a little chance to talk to each other. So we'll conclude. Look on the website. Our VR workshop is going to be coming up on the 15th at Wayne State, and we'll have details up on the website for that for November 15th. So besides that.
When you say the website, you mean meetup page?
Yeah, we got a, I didn't even go through everything. So we got a meetup page, we got a Facebook page, and we got a Slack page I'm trying to get started kind of rolling to. So it'll be in all those places, or you can contact me, and I'll let you know about you. Anything I'm forgetting is anybody, there's a VR, online VR workshop coming up too. It's like a two-day kind of thing, and I'll post information for that too if anybody's interested. It's just it's like an online kind of two-day workshop on VR, so it'll be pretty interesting.
If anyone hasn't ever... at least sample of mobile VR. I have several viewers and phones if you want to give it a shot for me.
Alright.
And this is much better than I've got a little Kinect system at home with two Kinects with a little
iPad
software.
Yeah.
So it was nice, but yeah, it's nowhere near what you guys are doing here, so it's great to see this.
Do we need to help you move the chairs around or anything?
No, but promise me that next time you do a VR seminar,
that
would
mean
sound like an actual
virtual.
Yeah.
Okay, next up.
But it's a VR meetup.
I have to not have VR. Next month, we will definitely have at least one.